Listening Library presents Trouble River by Betsy Byars. Read for you by Hal Hollings.
An uneasy feeling. The woman sat in the door of the cabin, rocking in her chair. With the hem of her apron, she fanned herself, saying over and over, "Where is that boy? Where is that boy?" She rose and moved to the open doorway where she looked out over the golden prairie. "Dewey!" she called, her voice breaking with anxiety. "Dewey!" When there was no answer, she went back to her rocking chair. "Dewey Martin!" she called from her chair. "Oh, Dewey!" After a moment, she went to stand in the doorway again. For as far as she could see, there was only the prairie, the long waving line of grass on the horizon, with not one single cabin or chimney in sight. The sun was dropping behind the horizon, and she knew how quickly darkness would cover the land, how quickly the colorful prairie would become desolate and cold. The lines between her brows deepened. "Well, I reckon I'll just have to go find him," she said to herself. Holding her walking cane and the side of the door for support, she stepped from the cabin and stood looking uncertainly about her. In the high grass to her right, a grouse flew up and she started, clutching her cane tightly. She feared the prairie with its strange sounds and long stillnesses. She had grown up in a town where one could hear the thud of a neighbor's axe, the drone of the sawmill, the ring of the fairy bell, the comforting sounds of other people. Here, there was only the lonely sighing of grass bent by the wind.
"Dewey!"
she called again. Her voice was softer, for now, outside the cabin, she feared not only for the boy's safety, but for her own.
"Dewey! Answer me, boy, if you hear me."
Hobbling slightly, she walked around the cabin toward the rise that overlooked the river. The dry prairie wind whipped her skirt about her thin legs.
"Dewey! Dewey! Oh, where is that boy? Dewey!"
Her answer came from below on the river.
"What do you want, Grandma?"
"Dewey Martin, I want you to get yourself up here right now. That's what I want. You hear me?"
"I'll be there in a minute."
"Right now. I'll be there in just one more minute," he said.
"I'm doing something real important."
"All right. You just stay on down there doing what's so important," she said. "And when your pa gets home and asks, did you mind, I'm going to say, that boy never minded me at all. He was doing something too important to mind. He was..."
"I'm coming. I'm coming."
"I ain't talking about coming in an hour or two. I want you right now."
Before she saw the boy, she saw his dog running up the path, and she shook her cane at him and said,
"Don't you upset me now, you worthless critter."
The dog ran past her. He knew the boy was heading for the cabin, and there was no greater pleasure in his life than beating him to the cabin and being there to greet him in the doorway.
"I don't see you, Dewey,"
the woman warned.
"I'm right here, Grandma."
She was silent as he made his way up the path, and then she said,
"Look at them feet."
With her cane, she pointed to the boy's feet, stained brown with mud from the river. He expected her to send him to the well with a gourd of soft soap. Instead, she said,
"What you been doing down at that river?"
"Nothing."
He ran into the weeds and up to the cabin. Brandishing her cane above her head, she made her way up the path.
"I said, what you been doing down at that river? No good, I bet."
"Making something," he said over his shoulder.
Then he came around the cabin, and the dog was there waiting for him in the doorway. His long tail was sweeping the cabin floor as hard as any broom.
"Good dog, Charlie, good dog,"
the boy said, rubbing him, and then the two of them rolled on the floor.
"You act like you ain't seen him in a year,"
the woman grumbled at the door. With the aid of her cane, she pulled herself into the cabin.
"Don't upset me now,"
she said as she passed the boy and the dog.
"That dog would rather upset me than eat meat."
She fell into her rocker with a sigh. Carefully, she patted her face with the hem of her apron.
It ain't safe out there, she said.
Pa wouldn't have left us if it wasn't safe, the boy said.
The truth of this was absolutely clear to him. His father had said they would be safe, and so they would be.
Well, maybe it was safe enough when he left, she conceded, rolling her eyes at him. But that was 4 days ago, and mark my words, a lot can happen out here in 4 days.
She rocked emphatically.
Wouldn't surprise me none if there was Indians all over the place by now.
You seen any Indians?
The boy asked. He stopped patting the dog and sat up on the floor.
Well, I ain't exactly seen any, she admitted. But it wouldn't surprise me none if they was out there watching us. You don't ever see an Indian till it's too late.
She stopped rocking and with her foot reached out and pushed the cabin door partially shut.
What was you doing down at the river?
Nothing.
She pointed at him with her cane and touched him on the shoulder with it so that he looked up at her.
I mean to know what you been doing down there every day,
she said firmly.
I said I was making something. All right, then. What was you making?
The boy laid his rumpled head on the dog.
I'm making me a sort of a boat,
he said finally in a low voice.
A boat? A boat?
She said.
I'd like to know where you're going in a boat.
Nowhere, I reckon. Just out on Trouble River. Anyway, it's more like a raft than a...
Trouble River,
she said. Her disgust was plain.
That ain't no river. Wouldn't a fish be caught dead in that yellow water?
She snorted.
A half mile wide and a half foot deep. That ain't no river. Why, I'd as soon eat mud as drink water from it.
She leaned forward. Her finger, pointing at him, trembled slightly.
You can't even swim in it for the quicksand. I heard your pa say so. It's good enough for a raft. It ain't good for nothing. Nothing. It ain't even good for getting across. Whole wagons have gone down in quicksand trying to get across, I've heard tell.
Not whole wagons, Grandma.
That's what I've heard tell,
she said stubbornly.
It'll suck the legs right off a horse.
She leaned back in her chair.
That's how it come to be named Trouble River.
It was named by some settlers who tried to cross after a heavy rain and lost their wagon. Pa said so.
Well, anyway, you got no right to be out there making a boat when you got chores. All the things around here that need fixing and you playing and making a boat, I never.
I knew you wouldn't like it,
he said with his mouth partially buried in the dog's fur.
That's why I didn't want to say nothing.
His grandma rocked more slowly now, and the boy stared out the cabin door at the enormous moon in the sky.
Your pa know about this here boat of yours?
She asked finally.
Yes'm. He let me use the horses to haul the logs.
And he's just as fool as you are.
She touched him again with her cane.
Don't you be getting in no trouble with it till your ma and pa gets back. You hear me?
Yes'm.
He paused a moment and then said,
I wish I was with them.
He closed his eyes.
I reckon they're in Hunter City now. If I was there, I'd be with Jimmy Sayers, and I could tell him about my raft. He didn't think I could...
Well, wishing ain't going to get you there,
she interrupted him.
Or me either.
I know.
Somebody's always got to stay to look after the animals.
Dewey rolled over and put his face beside the dog's. Half asleep, the dog roused long enough to lick the boy's cheek. Dewey closed his eyes and thought of Hunter's City with its buildings and tents. He thought of how it was to walk down the street and look in the tents and see men eating on long plank tables or gambling, of the sounds of the hurdy-gurdies and the laughter. He thought of walking along the canvas-covered wagons grouped by the river and talking to the immigrants, or standing in the back of the store and watching a checker game and munching on a hard kernel from the corn barrel. It seemed unfair that his parents were there where something was always happening, and he was left back at the cabin where everything was always the same.
It's dark,
Grandma said.
Better bar the door.
The boy got up at once, pushed the door shut, and set the stout bar across it. Then he lay back beside the dog on the rough floorboards. He watched his grandma carefully. He was eager for her to go to bed, for he planned, as soon as she was asleep, to slip down to the river again. Tonight, however, she was wide awake.
You going to bed, Grandma?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.